George Bloomfield, and I was born in Minden, Nebraska, and lived about 30 or 40 miles in that area my whole life. Grew up on the country on a farm, and then my mother died when I was 12. We moved to Kearney, and I received my bachelor's and my master's degrees there and taught at Axtell for a while, and then finished my degree later in life. I was about 40 at UNL. I commuted back and forth to Lincoln from Kearney and started teaching at UNK in 1988. And I've been teaching there ever since. I'm a professor of English. I think Nebraska and the plains, and especially the country, has had an immense effect on my life. I think you grow up with a sense of history, a sense of place, and a sense of community that you don't receive in other places. And I've always been a country girl, and I think I always will be. And I need to be where I can see the corn growing. And so I think most of the topics I've written a bit about have been women and people who are writing about the plains and writing about the pioneer times. And so I'm always wanting to know more about the beginnings and about where everything started. And so Nebraska is very, very important in my life and in my writing. Things were different back in the 50s and 60s, and so we didn't write very much. And the first time I did any creative writing was when I was in ninth grade, and a teacher named Jean Gallant had us write poetry and short stories and little dramas. And that was the first time in my life when I realized I could write a sentence. Before, I'd always diagram sentences, and it was always other people's sentences, and it was such an exciting, thrilling event to be able to write my own sentences. And so I became really involved in journalism, then in high school, and journalism in college. And then I took a class with Don Welch, who is a great Nebraska poet. And he inspired me not only to understand about writing nonfiction and essays, but also I took every class he took about literature and creative writing classes with Don Welch. And so he really spurred my interest and made me change my major to English. Mm-hmm. And so he was probably one of the most important undergraduate influences in my life. Mm-hmm. Then when I came back, and then I audited a lot of his courses. Every time he had a course, I would audit it while I was getting my master's degree. And then when I started coming to UNL for my PhD, there were a couple of people who were really major influences in my life. One of them was Barbara DeBernard. I took a women's literature class with her, and she introduced me to a whole bunch of women writers I'd never read before. And she especially introduced me to the work of Tilly Olson from Nebraska. And we studied the work Silences, which was probably a turning point in my life, because I too felt like I had sort of been silenced because of where I was and being a mother at home and living in the middle of nowhere. And so I started on a quest to find out more of these other women writers who were silenced. And then the next person that changed my life was Fran Kay. I took a Plains Literature course with her, and she was so supportive, and she introduced me to Eleanor Pruitt Stewart, which was the topic of my first book. She encouraged my research, she encouraged my writing, she helped me find grant money and research money to go visit the Stewart family in Oregon, and was so very supportive of my work. And so they've been a wonderful help. And the last person is Helen Stauffer, who was a professor at UNK, and she is a biographer of Maury Sandoz. And she is from Kearney, and she has always been supportive of me when in the conferences and in my research and in my writing, and has been a really good friend. So I have had really major people influence me in my life. I've been very lucky to have them help me along the way. I think the topics and the themes that usually draw me have some sort of historical implication to them. You know, I read a lot of modern writers, but somehow I'm always drawn into the past. I enjoy doing archival research. I enjoy doing the primary reading of documents and newspapers and microfilm. I have my own microfilm reader. And to me, it's so intriguing to hear the real stories. To me, they're much more interesting than the fictional stories, and learning about real people and the lives they lived. And when you look back at how people lived and how people acted and reacted, you realize how much really hasn't changed and how we're alike in many ways and how history does repeat itself. And you can see sort of a continuum or sort of a circle going on. And to me, I really like that continuity, that finding of your beginnings, the origins, where we come from and where we're going, and learning about other people's lives. You asked me about the best time I have to work. I teach full-time at the University of Nebraska at Kearney, and so I teach 3 courses a semester. I have around 60 to 75 students a semester, and most of them are writing courses. So most of my writing time is in the summer, and I love horses, and so I usually get up early in the morning and go horseback riding and do my gardening and do all of my chores and try to be at my desk around 10 or 11. And then I usually write for a long period of time until 5 or 6, or do research. I have that time for my writing and research time. However, if I had my druthers, my choices, I really would like to write in the evening and late at night, start around 9 o'clock, write until 2 or 3 in the morning when everything is quiet and everything has been done for the day. But that doesn't always work when you have to get up and go to school the next day and have other people in your life. But usually I write for long stretches in the afternoons and usually in the summer. I think my voice and my style has changed a lot, hopefully for the better, over the years. I started out being very objective and being very scholarly in my first book. And I noticed that in my second book on Kate Clary, although I was scholarly, I tried to have more description, tried to do a little bit more interpretation, a little bit more of a subjective input into the book. And on my one on Eliopedi, I tried to be even more of a storyteller, to lose even more of that scholarly tone. I mean, there's tons of footnotes everywhere, but I tried to keep my voice more storytelling. I'm working on a new piece now that is going to be, I don't really know what to call it. I was talking to Fran Kay and she called it a biography of my farm, because everything I've done has been a biography. I think that's what it is. It's a biography of 160 acres. And I'm starting back when the Pawnees were on the land, and then when the first homesteaders, and then my family through 4 generations, which will also be a history of farming. And I want to use more of a narrating, storytelling voice and try to work historical aspects into it too. So I'm going more and more toward creative nonfiction and more away, hopefully, from the more scholarly types of writing. I think the audience that I write for is for a general educated audience, people who love to read, people who like history, people who want to learn something, not necessarily people who want fantasy or escape or just pure entertainment. And so that's who my audience is. I have the advice that I used to give to my students who want to be writers is, first of all, read as much as you can of the type of writing that you want to write, because then you can say, yes, I like this, and I don't like that, and you can pick and choose from all these different writers and develop, not copy someone, but find elements of all these different things that then sum up to be who you are. And to me, that's the most important thing to do. The second thing would be, if possible, attend these. There's a lot of wonderful writing workshops, whether it's the Nebraska Literary Guild, the University of Nebraska at Lincoln has a wonderful workshop in the summer. UNK and UNO are now offering an MFA in creative writing, and they have a great low residency program with workshops. Mm-hmm. And they're all over the United States. There are workshops to go to meet people, to have someone give you more professional advice on your writing. Mm-hmm. And then I think a third place to go, or an alternative place to go, would be various local writers groups. I know there are some wonderful ones in Lincoln. We have some good ones in the Kearney area. I know there's a group out in the western part of the state. Mm-hmm. So you need to find out who these different writers groups are, who will give you feedback, and who will also keep you writing. You know, sometimes you tend to stop for take a break because something comes up, and then it's really hard to get started again. But if you have a writer's group that keeps you writing, keeps the ideas flowing, I think that's really important. So that's the advice I give to writers. I've just finished a book that was accepted by the University of Nebraska Press. It will come out next year. There's a project that I've been working on. Again, it's historical. Right now the working title is Adventures in the West, and it's a collection of family stories about the West written by people who were living here in the West at the time the West was actually being settled. So the stories are pretty much firsthand, and they're wonderfully written. And for each of the stories in the anthology, we've set them, a graduate student, Eric, has helped me edit this. And we set it up so we're giving historical background on each of the stories. For example, the Oklahoma land rush, or the Johnson County wars, or, you know, prairie fires, or whatever it is. Plus, each story has some sort of a value or a moral or some point it's trying to make, and we discuss that. And then we give a little background on the authors. A lot of them are totally unknown now, and they were fairly well known then, and a couple of them we haven't been able to find. And so I'm really excited about this project. It'll be coming out in the spring of 2007. So that, I just finished that up. And I'm also working on this family history / biography of my farm. That I decided that I have written biographies of the Stewart family, the Clary family, and the Petey family, and I know more about their family than I do mine. And so I thought maybe it'd be time that I write something about myself. And my son said, why don't you write about four generations on our quarter? I thought, that's a good idea. And I started thinking about it, and we've had a lot of struggles, you know, so far. You know, my grandfather had to quit because of World War I, and then my father came back after World War II and tried to farm and couldn't make a go of it. And my ex-husband farmed, but the farm crisis hit. And as I was looking through the original homesteaders, the land turned over two or three times a year sometimes. Mm-hmm. It was almost musical chairs on all these homesteads. And so I think what I'd like to highlight is the struggles and hopefully the successes for my son, you know, of living and working with the land, and how things have changed from my grandfather, who farmed with a horse and a plow, to my son who's using GPS. So I'm excited about this project. The book that I'm going to read from tonight is called Impertinences, the Selected Editorials and Writings of Elia Petey, a Journalist in the Gilded Age. And it was published by the University of Nebraska Press. And this book begins with a chapter that sets up her life up to the time she came to Omaha in 1888. And then the middle part of the book are five chapters about different topics that she wrote about while she was a journalist on the Omaha World Herald. And then my last chapter is the rest of the biography of her life after she goes back to Chicago and then goes to North Carolina. So I'm going to talk a little bit about her life, and then I'm going to read excerpts from all of the stories. In addition, each one of the stories that I have of Elia's, you know, I'm big into context. I have set up each one of the chapters with background on that topic, and then each of the writings that she has, I've given historical backgrounds, because sometimes the people or the places are not here anymore, or people don't remember them, or the customs, or the culture of that time period. And then each one of the stories has an archival photograph to illustrate it, either of the subject or of the time period or of the topic itself in general. So that's what I'll be doing tonight.
Good evening, and thanks for coming this evening. My name is Meredith McGowan, and I am the curator of the Heritage Room. I'd like to welcome you to the Heritage Room and to the John H. Ames Reading Series. It's a series that's been in existence for over 20 years, and we're pretty excited to still be doing this. We are here in the Jane Pope Geske Heritage Room. This is a special collection dedicated to promoting and preserving works by and about Nebraska authors. We have about 12,000 volumes or so, and 3,000 authors or so. So we're also excited about that. We invite you to come to the Heritage Room during regular public service hours. We are open on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday from 12 to 3, and on Sunday afternoons from 2 to 5. So we'd welcome your visit anytime. We'd also like to thank the Nebraska Literary Heritage Association. We're able to bring special programs like these to you because of an endowment that was established through their volunteer efforts. Tonight our reader is Suzanne George Bloomfield. She is our 161st reader. So, She has lived in Nebraska all of her life, although she's moved around the state a little bit. She's received degrees from UNL and UNK. She is currently at the University of Nebraska-Kearney as an English professor, and she also is a colleague of Charles Ford, who did an earlier Ames reading for us. Suzanne holds the Martin Distinguished Professorship and has won awards for teaching, research, and service. She's published a number of books. She does seem to be interested, though, in women who lived in Nebraska some years ago. The first book that I noticed was The Adventures of the Woman Homesteader, The Life and Letters of Eleanor Pruitt Stewart, and then another, Kate M. Cleary, A Literary Biography with Selected Works, and most recently, Impertinences, Selected Editorials of Elia W. Peattie, a journalist in the Gilded Age. And they were, incidentally, all published by the University of Nebraska Press. So we're glad about that, too. We are happy to have Suzanne Bloomfield here with us this evening. Please help me welcome her.
Well, thank you for inviting me to read in the series. I'm very pleased and honored to be chosen to be among the readers here. And I'd also like to thank some of my special friends. It's nice to see you in the audience tonight. What I'm going to do is read from Impertinences. I'm going to begin with a little bit of background in her life and then read some excerpts from some of her writings. And I do have a PowerPoint presentation and a helper that we've never worked this together, so hopefully everything will go fairly smoothly. I'd like to begin with a little bit from my preface. Impertinences is a collection of editorials, columns, and stories written by Elia Wilkinson Peattie for the Omaha World Herald during her sojourn in Omaha, Nebraska from 1888 to 1896. It attempts to enlarge our ever-growing understanding of women's writings at the end of the 19th century and to help clarify a major turning point in American history, especially in the booming West. Peattie grew up during the Gilded Age, roughly the two decades after the Civil War, when industry expanded, the Transcontinental Railroad united the country physically, and waves of immigration increased America's population. It was the age of the Victorian true woman, when purity, piety, submissiveness, and domesticity defined the role of women and centered them firmly in the home. Toward the end of the century, new scientific thought ushered in the progressive era, and the new woman, a product of the women's movement initiated in the 1840s, began to challenge the status quo. Women started demanding the right to equal education and career opportunities, as well as the stronger political rights and responsibilities. Entering adulthood as the progressive era emerged into the Gilded Age suited Peattie perfectly. She was an intellectual woman who wanted a career, but she was also a devoted wife and mother. Described as tall, dignified, and kindly, and possessing a wicked sense of humor, Peattie exemplified an increasing number of late 19th century women who balanced their desire for independence and universal rights with their maternal womanly instincts and needs. For the first time, American women had a choice. They could remain contentedly in the home, follow a professional career, or as in Peattie's case, attempt to harmonize the private and the public spheres. Peattie struggled to grow as an individual, to gain respect as a professional, and to balance family and career is one that women still face today. Peattie spent most of her life in the Midwest, but the 9 years she spent in Omaha were important to her as a writer and as a woman at the close of the 19th century. Although much of Peattie's work was published to help support her family, some of her best works, her writings appearing regularly in the Omaha World Herald and her short stories collected in The Mountain Woman, were written while she was living in Omaha. During her years on the World Herald, Peattie influenced the women of Nebraska as well as people across the United States, not only with the dignity with which she led her life, the compassion she felt for others, and the fierceness with which she defended her beliefs, but also with her professionalism. Her writings serve political, cultural, and social functions as it expanded her own horizons as a woman and as a writer. And this is a photograph of Elia. Oh, you want to click it one more time? When she was the president of the Omaha Women's Club in Omaha. She was born in 1862 and she died in 1935. What I'd like to do now is just go through briefly a little background on her life. Elia was born in 1862 in Kalamazoo, Michigan. Her father never really had enough money, and he spent a lot of money, but he never spent it on material for the family. They never had books, they never had magazines. They were really never encouraged much in their education. And so when the Chicago fire happened, he decided that was when he was going to go to Chicago, and so he moved his family to Chicago in 1871 so they could make a lot of money off the fire. Well, of course, he didn't make any money on that either, but he got a job as a printer, and that wasn't going well either, and so Elia had to quit school after the sixth grade to help her father in the print shop. And whenever there were any down, and of course she had no books or magazines at home, but she had the dictionary. And so whenever there was any downtime at work, she would read the dictionary. And if you have read any of her works, you realize her vocabulary is just incredible. And when the copy editor and I were going through this, we'd question Elia's word choice, and she was always right. So her vocabulary is just amazing. 6 years later, after working for her father, her mother had a fourth daughter, Bertha, and so she was not very well, and so Elia had to quit her job and go home and become the mother to the family. That same year, when she was 15 years old, she met Robert. This is a picture of when he was a reporter in Chicago. She met him at a dance, and they fell in love immediately, and they were engaged for 6 years. Meanwhile, he was working as a reporter, and then her father moved them farther out into the country. They had a really hard time seeing each other, but their love endured. Finally, when Elia was 20, she was still taking care of the whole family, mothering not only her sisters, but also her mother and her father. She had a nervous breakdown, and the doctors told her that she needed to get away, and so she left home and went to stay with a friend, and she never went back. The next year, she and Robert were married in 1883. And Eugene Field, who was a reporter with Robert, was their best man. Okay, the next one. 9 months after they were married, Edward was born. And then on their second anniversary, Barbara was born in 1885. During these years, they lived with Robert's widowed mother, and both of them wrote and wrote and wrote. Elia has said that she was the first woman reporter for the Chicago Tribune, and she also said she was the first, quote, girl reporter in Chicago. We can't verify those facts, but those are the ones. I haven't been able to not verify them either, but she was one of the very earliest reporters during that time period. And one more time. In 1888, Gilbert Hitchcock made an offer to Robert to come and be the managing editor of the Omaha Daily Herald. And he also told Elia that she would have a job on the staff also, and she would be able to write bylined articles. And so they were really excited that they both would have full-time jobs, bylined articles, and have a good income finally. And so they took up the offer and moved to Omaha. Well, things didn't work as well as planned because the Omaha Herald was having financial difficulty, and so was the Omaha World. And so Hitchcock decided to combine both of the newspapers into one. And after a while, they did receive a little bit more financial security, and they both wrote for the newspapers. But Elia had to do a lot of other writing on the side to help make ends meet. When they were living in Chicago, they were also supporting Robert's widowed mother and Elia's sister Bertha, as well as the two children that they had and the ones that would follow. Okay, one more time. One of the best things that happened to Elia in her first years in Omaha was that I think a neighbor of theirs was acquainted with someone who worked for Northwestern Railroad. And at that time, they were doing all sorts of different excursion lines and doing different resorts and different packages for vacations. And so he wanted to know if she wanted to take the trip, the whole trip on the railroad, and go up on the cruise ship to Alaska and then write a story about it as a guidebook. And so she got a free trip for writing this guidebook. And so she went to every town and found out the information about all the towns and wrote this guidebook. What's unique about this is that Elia just couldn't write a dull, boring guidebook. She had to make it into a story. So she had a guy named Scott Key, who was suffering from a broken heart, who was on this trip to heal his heart. And of course, he meets this woman that he falls in love with on one of the glaciers in Alaska. So she had to make it a piece of literature. She just couldn't let it be as it was. Also, at this time, they also got some more money because she, every time there was a short story contest or a writing contest, she would enter it and win the prize money. Well, the Detroit Free Press had a contest for a novel, and so she wrote a novel, The Judge, supposedly based on a true incident in Chicago. And she won the contest, won $900, and then Rand McNally, who also published A Journey Through Wonderland, published the novel. And with that $900, they were able to buy a house. And the house is still standing on Poppleton Avenue right near Hanscom Park in Omaha. A beautiful, almost two-and-a-half-story house. Okay. In 1891, Roderick was born. And click the next one. And in 1892 was a really interesting year for her. She was supposedly the first person to write an editorial or any article endorsing William Jennings Bryan for president. And she was very active in the Populist Party, worked very closely with William Jennings Bryan, and she also wrote a story called Jim Lancey's Waterloo about the terrible desperations of American farmers that they distributed as propaganda and that was later published in a magazine. And then in 1893, she was very instrumental in starting the first women's club in Nebraska, the Omaha Women's Club. And then later on, she helped to organize the Nebraska Federation of Women's Clubs and was also got the Nebraska Federation to join the National Federation. And when she went to the National Confederation, she was on the stage and shared the stage with Susan B. Anthony. And so she was really important. And she would also travel all over the state and help other small towns organize their women's clubs. And at that time, the women's club movement was very important. The thing that she liked most about being in the women's club, the work that she did, was that she was one of the main instigators of the traveling library, so that every town in Nebraska had a chance to have books that they could read. Towns that did not have any libraries, and so she was most proud of that. In 1896, Elia published A Mountain Woman, a series of stories about the West, and also in that same year, Robert, whose health had been bad through all of these years, his health got so bad that he wasn't able to work at the Omaha World Herald, and he lost his position there, and he finally got a job in New York City working in New York City, so he tried working there. Finally, later in that year, the family went back to Chicago and they lived together, and then both Elia and Robert began working for the Chicago Tribune, and they worked with the Chicago Tribune then until they retired. While they were in Chicago, Donald was born, their last child. Donald said he was born to the sound of clacking typewriters, and he too is a very famous naturalist writer. Also, from 1901 to 1917, Elia is the literary critic for the Chicago Tribune. She wrote 10 books, she read and reviewed 10 books a week, and she figured that she wrote over 5,000 book review columns. She kind of complained that it ruined her creativity. She didn't have really time to write what she wanted to write because she needed the money to support her family and to get the children through school. The children went to Harvard and all of the really good schools, but she felt that that was the most important thing. In 1915, she publishes The Precipice. This book has been republished. It's probably her most important book. It's a story about a social worker who is trying to, like Petey, reconcile her job and her work, But it's also very important because it talks about the settlement houses in Chicago, like the Hull House. And so it's good as an historical novel also. It's called a suffragette novel. Later that year, Barbara dies of a streptococcus infection, leaving two young boys. And they move back for a while to help them in New York City. And Elia could no longer ride after that. In 1920, the Petys decided to retire at Den Wandren in Tyron, North Carolina, and they took Elia's mother, went with them to live. And so they've always had family members that they were supporting throughout their life. When they were living in Tyron, Elia became Tryon. I always call her like Tryon. Elia was very active, of course, in the Woman's Club, in the Garden Club. She was writing plays for the Dramatics Club in the town. And she also was very influential and worked a lot in the Sidney Lanier Library. And she was a lover of Sidney Lanier's works. In 1930, Robert died at 72 years, I think. And Elia died in 1935 at the same age. I love that picture of her. It's very noble. Throughout Elia's life, she wrote an amazing amount. It's just unbelievable. I have a bibliography that I have been working on for probably 8 years of all of the works. And I'm on the eBay search, and every time anything comes in on Eliapedia, it pops up on my computer. And I have found probably 8 to 10 stories in these totally unknown magazines, like the TP magazine that published for 2 years in South Dakota. I mean, every magazine that you can think of, she published in. She also wrote editorials and columns. I counted up the amount of fiction, short stories, editorials, and columns that she wrote in the 8 years that she was there, and she wrote 800. And that's in addition to all of the other novels and stories that she was writing at the same time. She wrote several novels. I have many of them on the back shelf. She wrote a lot of short stories that were published in Cosmopolitan, St. Nicholas, Century Magazine, Woman, in every magazine I think that published, she contributed something to it. She also wrote popular fiction. When they needed to remodel their home in Chicago, she wrote 100 of those little short, like Harlequin romance type stories, 100 of them in 100 days, and that paid for the remodeling of their house. She also really, she liked to write poetry, but poetry really didn't pay very well. But she also started a column that she had in the paper called Poems You Ought to Know, sort of like what Ted Kooser's doing today. She'll find a poem that she thought people should read, and she'll write a little bit about it. And then it was on the front page of the Chicago Tribune. And then she, of course, she always did double duty for everything. She collected all those in a book or two. She wrote plays later on in her life. She wrote plays for the Woman's Club that they would have at their national conferences. She collected, she was really smart. Whenever she'd get a bunch of short stories together, like The Shape of Fear, all of her ghost stories she would collect. And then she had another collection of stories about food and another collection of children's stories. And she would serialize a children's novel and use companion. She'd have it published in a book. So she almost got paid twice for everything that she wrote. She wrote histories. This one is what is interesting. When she was in Omaha, she wrote the story of America, the whole history of America up to that point. It was 700 pages long. I have it back there. She wrote that in 4 months, dictating it to 2 stenographers, and wrote the whole, and it's an amazing book. You know, she did the research, and as she was researching it, she just dictated it to these stenographers. She wrote nonfiction articles. One of my favorite ones is The Middle-Aged Woman. It's a fun one to read. Children's stories and novels, a lot of children's and stories and novels. Youth Companion and St. Nicholas paid top dollar for their stories. And again, they could be published then in children's form. She wrote a series of novels about a girl named Azalea, series in about the Blue Ridge Mountains. So there's been now actually it's being made into a play, I think. And of course, her literary criticisms for the Chicago Tribune. What I decided to do for my book was to divide the 800 things that I found in the Omaha World Herald, and I actually made copies of all of them. So I was trying to divide them into different categories, and I could probably do about 6 books. So I put them together, and for this particular collection, I divide them into works about early Omaha. In one of them, she takes a trolley car ride from the southern part of Omaha up to the northern part, and she describes everything she sees along the way. Describes shopping in Omaha, the stockyards, the African-American population in Omaha. The next one is Fact and Fiction. That's one of my favorite ones. She will take a headline story, a news event, and then she'll write an editorial or a feature story, a factual story on it, and then she'll turn around and she'll write a fiction story about it. And so she did several of those. Another one is Community Concern. She was very philanthropic, and she was always working for either charities for the orphanages, for the charity hospitals, and so she devoted a lot of, for the Salvation Army, she devoted a lot of columns to trying to help those causes to get money for them. A Word for the Women, I put my favorite articles that were very, very woman-centered, from, you know, what is an ideal marriage, to raising children, to women having equality and having equal rights. And then she traveled all over Nebraska, and she wrote about a woman who raised hogs in Fremont, and a nun in Hastings, and the beet factory in Norfolk, and hunting. This man, he was a hunting maniac. And so, and about Kate Cleary, her best friend, my other book was about, and Willa Cather. So, and this is just a portion of what she had written. So what I'd like to do tonight is to read to you a little bit from some of these chapters, and I have them illustrated. And the first one that I'd like to read is from my chapter called Fact and Fiction, and it's called Lovely Woman and the Indians. Now, for each of these chapters, I have an introduction to the chapter that sets up the background for the chapter. And then for each of the individual writings, I have an archival photograph and some background that tells you something about the story itself before I give Ilya's story. So I'm going to read them both. Native Americans, too, found an advocate in Petey. She looked behind the rhetoric of manifest destiny, questioned the native negative stereotypes, and respected their customs, religion, and the rights of the first Americans. Although she was not a lone voice in their support, most news stories of the day did little to foster positive attitudes toward them. In January 1891, shortly after the slaughter of the Lakota Ghost Dancers, as well as women and children at Wounded Knee, Petey wrote 2 editorials in support of Native Americans. Influenced by her friend and associate Thomas Tibbles, an editorial writer and reporter for the Omaha World Herald, Petey had firsthand information. On November 30, 1890, the day after the Wounded Knee tragedy, the World Herald published Tibbles' eyewitness account, which called the event a war of extermination. He reported that Native American casualties totaled 106 men and 252 women and children. Only 56 Sioux survived, mostly women and children, and all but 2 were wounded. With emotions running high among Nebraskans, Petey first chose a logical appeal, urging her readers, especially the women, to learn the facts rather than rely on emotion in trying to understand the situation. She provided a comprehensive list of historical and contemporary works about Native Americans to educate her readers out of their barbarism. And so I'll just read you parts of this. There used to be every reason why a woman should be governed by her heart and her prejudices instead of her brain, but there is no longer such an excuse for her. Whatever the college's practical experience in life, fiction, reading, and opportunity for comparison of ideas can do for her has been done. Therefore, if she shows a mental passion in the place of mental judgment, she confesses to a defect, which may be temperamental or a part of her femininity, as one chooses to believe. Of course, I hope it's temperamental. Concerning the Indian troubles, which are now reaching their tragic climax, I have noticed that the women have used less judgment in expressing their opinions on the matter than some of the men. They choose to indiscriminately pity or detest the Indian. Those who pity appear a great deal lovelier than those who detest, because pity is a womanly emotion, and detestation is not womanly, though perhaps it is feminine enough. I am sure that there are plenty of exceptions to the rule, but I fear that few women think nothing about the abstract justice of this affair. The maintenance of an abstract sentiment is of more importance than the exercise of mercy in some specific case. What I mean to say is, the reason why the United States government should treat the Indian with justice has nothing to do with the deserts of the Indian. I heard a lady say the other evening after the news of Wounded Knee Massacre had reached the city, "The dirty wretches, they ought to be killed." She used the word dirty in the sense of uncleanliness. I suppose she thought that they were worthy of extinction merely because they were not acquainted with perfume soap. As a matter of fact, the government has chosen to give them very limited rations of soap. No one could keep clean on it. However, not to digress, I will admit I heard a gentleman say something as ridiculous. "The treacherous dogs," cried he, "after they had surrendered, to turn and fire?" That is always the way in Indian warfare. In civilized fighting, such an occurrence would have been impossible. He had not chosen to understand the situations. Most persons seem to prefer misunderstanding every Indian situation. The gentleman must have known that the Indians at Wounded Knee could not have surrendered, since there had been no engagement. They saw themselves surrounded by soldiers, with four frightful guns looking down at them from the tops of the dunes, and they in the hollow. About them were their teepees with their wives and children. It looked like the last act of a long tragedy. They were weak with hunger. They were fearful of involving all those they loved in their own disaster. Yet they fought with a grim heroism that in a less despised race would be the subject for 100 songs. These are the facts. How can they be perverted? There is no use in calling the statement of fact sentimentalism, because fact is not sentiment, however pathetic it may be, any more than fact is fiction. What I started out to do in this article was to recommend to every woman who intends to take up a course of reading for the winter a study of the Indian history of this country. And then she lists hundreds and hundreds of pages. She ends by saying, "Therefore, if it comes in the way of any of you to feed a hunted woman, to care for a child dying from a United States bullet, to nurse a baby whose innocent lips hunger for the cold breast of its murdered mother, to speak kindly to a man whose eyes gleam with the despair of the condemned, it will be counted for so much glory to you in the day of the future reckoning, which all of us believe, in the midst of our doubt, will surely come." And then she turns around and she writes a story on the 4th of January. One more click. Called The Triumph of Starved Crow. After appealing to her reader's intellect, Petey penned a sentimental sketch titled The Triumph of Starved Crow to add pathos to her argument. Using a fictional Indian character she named Starved Crow, she narrated the events of Wounded Knee from the perspective of Native Americans and a priest, Father Francis M.J. Craft, a dedicated Indian missionary who may have been of Mohawk heritage. Father Craft wanted to be of service, quote, he says, "as malicious whites and on and near all agencies during the present excitement have, by misrepresenting the intentions of the army, caused such a state of alarm and suspicion among the Indians as to make it possible for the least excitement or misunderstanding to precipitate serious trouble." As a result of his compassion, Father Craft suffered a severe knife wound that punctured his right lung. However, he survived the battle, whereas most of his Indian friends perished. And this is an actual portrait of a woman survivor from Wounded Knee. This is from the Nebraska State Historical Society collection. So I'll read just parts of this story. And this is a fictional account. "A place where the hills and the hollows seem made by the devil and not by God, a stretch of unfinished earth where the fires of the innermost globes surge to the surface and smolder hideously, a land where the trees writhe as if they were in torment, where the buttes rise bare and brown in shapes fantastical, and the treacherous ravines drop with malicious suddenness. Such are the badlands of the Dakotas. The caillous can barely follow the wild paths. There are places where even the rabbits can die of hunger. There is only one thing that can drive a white man there. It is greed. An Indian can be driven there only by fear. For an Indian likes pleasant pastures for his herds and streams where the fish are and where the cattle love to drink. It was fear that drove Starved Crow there, and he took his wife with him and the two little ones. The baby had died the week before because the milk in the mother's breast had dried up. Father Kraft, who spoke only blessings, muttered something that sounded like a malediction when he looked at the dead baby. And so then they have the Indians who are staying in the Badlands, and they're concerned about the soldiers. Perhaps they thought if they could stand the cold a while out there in the wilderness, the soldiers would leave or forget them, or they could return in safety. Father Kraft, every night, when the young braves talked together, walked among them and preached patience, peace. And he was more than a preacher. He was a friend. "What can you do against so many?" said he, when one, wilder than the rest and younger, said they had a right to return to the land which was theirs and the houses they had built. "Better wait a while here, harming no one. Perhaps there's been some mistake." At last, Sioux came riding hard on the cayuses. "They say you were at war, hiding here from the soldiers. You must get back or they will come out to battle. You will be killed. They will surround you. And you cannot fight, for you are hungry. You must come back." Father Kraft looked puzzled. So, of course, the Indians then returned to the agency. By and by, the band reached Wounded Knee. Here they rested. "Patience and peace," said Father Kraft continually. "Who knows but some good will come of it all. The good father in Washington will hear how hungry you all are and will send you more food. He will learn how your crops have failed, how the corn burned up at ripening time, how poor is the land that has been given you, and he will see your wrongs righted. Remember, patience and peace." And of course, you know what happened with the massacre. And then at the very end of the story, after the Native Americans have all been fired upon, said, "Hours after the men came to carry away the dying, Little White Bear, though only a baby, lay with a hole in his throat. When they gave him water to drink, it ran out of his neck. But his feverish hands held the crucifix that had fallen. He was still playing with it and babbling inarticulately. There were so many dead that it was easy to care for the wounded. Someone stooped over Starved Crow. He rolled back his eyes and lay perfectly still. They passed on. He wanted no care from his foes. He would not be nursed back to life, only to be killed again." And so she uses reason and sentiment in order to get her points across in her stories. Okay, the next one that I'd like to read is from the chapter, A Word with the Women. And this is How Not to Treat Babies. This is not, I have an archival photograph in the book that's different from this one I really like. But I like this one because that's my father on the left. I also have a picture of my grandmother in the book. You can do that when you're an author, right? In 1923, when Petey returned to Omaha to lecture, she told a reporter that babies had always been her chief amusement. Quote, "And over and above this and under and around it is the sense of satisfaction and joy which only children can give." Petey enjoyed her children throughout all of their developmental stages, encouraging their imaginative play, supporting their individuality, and promoting their sense of self-worth. Typical of progressive-era parents, the Peteys encouraged extended educational opportunities, enhanced recreational activities, and the development of moral, ethical, and religious ideals. As the 20th century neared, society began viewing the homemaker as a professional whose job required training and scientific knowledge. Experts wrote child-rearing manuals with strict rules for raising the young, and these became Bibles for late 19th century mothers. When Nell Nelson, a former Chicago reporter, wrote an article for the New York Sun on raising children, Petey disagreed with her scientific child-rearing advice. She has this huge whole page-long list of some of the advice that Nell Nelson gives. I'll just read a few of them. This is Petey's article. Nell Nelson has been telling the readers of the New York Sun what not to do with their babies. This is what she says. Don't rock the baby. Don't let him sleep in a warm room. Don't let him nap in the afternoon. Don't let him be kissed. Don't cool his food by blowing on it. Don't feed him with a tablespoon. Don't use a tube nursing bottle. Don't bathe him more than 3 times a week. Don't let him eat at the family table. Don't let him eat meat until he is 2. Don't let him sleep on a pillow. Don't whip him. Don't make him cry. Don't frighten him. Don't shake him. Don't dance, jump, or dangle him. Don't overfeed him. Don't let him sleep with an adult. Don't let him swallow things or eat ashes. Don't let him roll downstairs. Don't let him fall out of windows. Don't teach him to walk. Don't wash him with lye soap. Don't starch any of his clothes. Don't worry him. Don't give him anything to eat between meals. Now, Nell Nelson, as she is known to the world, is a dear, good girl. I have known her many years. We have been to weddings together, to conventions together, to races together. We have, in short, met everywhere that the two busiest women in Chicago employed on rival newspapers would be likely to meet. We have hired cabs together to save cab hire and lunched together at gruesome hours of the night after hours for mutual protection. We have helped each other out in all sorts of ways. And after an acquaintance of this sort, I am bound to say that for a friend in rainy and sunshiny weather, in work hours and out of them, Nell is about as sensible a woman as one finds. She used to teach school all day and report half the night to keep her mother and band of sisters and brothers in food and clothes. But when it comes to the question of babies, I object. She doesn't know anything about them. She has been consulting some old maid who lectures on the bringing up of children and has taken notes on the remarks of the old maid. If Nell ever gets to heaven and St. Peter asks her any questions, she will surely take notes on the subject, and after she gets in the Gold Gate, will mechanically write up a fashion report on the latest fad in angel's wings. So I'm sure she has been taking notes about babies. There are a number of things on this list of negations which I do not quarrel. There are others that are superfluous. For example, it is not customary, so far as I know, among mothers of any class to let their children roll downstairs. One may say there's a fixed prejudice against that sort of thing. Neither is the eating of ashes considered good form. But there are a number of things to which I would like to object. Nell says the babies are not to be kissed. I once had a nurse whom I disliked without being able to tell why. She was the soul of neatness. She never neglected her charges. She was a good Christian, so she said, and used to read the Bible while I dusted the nursery. One day my little girl fell down. I hadn't time to kiss her myself, so I asked Lena to do it. A kiss with my babies has all of the curative qualities of patent medicine and is warranted to cure broken heads, pricked fingers, smashed dolls, lost drumsticks, rainy days, and bleeding noses. I never kiss children, ma'am, said Lena with a superior accent. It is not hygienic. I stopped to kiss Barbara so that she would stop crying and I could talk. Lena, I said, do you mean to tell me that all the time that you have been here, you have never kissed the babies? Certainly not, returned Lena, lifting her colorless eyebrows. There is no manner in which contagious diseases can be more readily transmitted than by kissing. Those were Lena's words. She had taken a course at some kind of a place where they taught massage and grammar. My dear girl, she said, I am really very sorry, but could I trouble you to go out this afternoon and look for a new place? Stay here till you can get one, but please make a strong effort to get one soon, for I feel that we cannot live up to your standard of hygiene. Then I got a good fat Irish girl who would not sew on the children's buttons, but who kissed them as naturally as she took a drink of water when she was thirsty, and I felt a great deal better. And she comments on a lot of the other ones too. Nell also says that the baby is not to have a nap in the afternoon. But there is no call to talk about that subject. The babies will settle it. They will not ask permission to take the nap. They will help themselves to it. She also says we are not to give him anything to eat between meals. As a penalty for this, I would like to make the dear girl take care of a teething baby about 2 months old who has had nothing to eat between meals. Still, perhaps the punishment would be too severe for the crime. But Nell is absolutely wrong here. Nell says we are not to blow on the baby's food to cool it. It would be good fun to see Nell some afternoon with a very impatient, assertive baby in a bowl of hot gruel. It would indeed. It would not work well with her injunction not to shake him nor let him cry, for both things would happen as sure as guns. I like the idea of bathing a baby 3 times a week. Some mothers bathe far too often. It's very exhausting for some children, and I think friction should always be got up after a bath. I am very certain that I like the idea of not frightening him in any way at all. Neither would I have him be shown anything or told of anything that is not good and beautiful. I like my children to hear pleasant stories, see pleasing pictures, and then I firmly believe they will speak pleasant words and have pleasant faces. And they have, bless them. Poor Nell Nelson. I can afford to disagree with her. She has no babies. Okay, the next story that I'd like to read. It's one of my favorites, called Barriers Against Women, and it's again in the same chapter, A Word for the Women. In January 1895, after reading an article about Cardinal Gibbons, one of the most outspoken churchmen against the new woman, Petey wrote a righteous response. It seems then that it is not for truth, honor, industry, sobriety, intellectual development, and spiritual growth that woman is altered or honored or exalted, but merely because she can bear children. Gibbons feared that education would turn women away from family and religion, but Petey disagreed. The new woman, as she is ridiculously called, finds in her college, her clubs, and her social intercourse the very things that teach her how great is her responsibility to her kind. Turn the light on. Let it flood the whole world, the light of learning and liberty. If this loses any woman a man's love, his love is well lost. If it keeps children from being born, they are well in their oblivion. Taking issue with Gibbons' comment that the cardinal virtues of women are chastity and humility, Petey chided, it is unfortunate that it seems to be the chief occupation of the large part of men to destroy the first, chastity, and to identify the second, humility, with servitude. Petey reproached women, too, for restricting the growth of other women, especially by resenting each other's abilities and successes or by fearing genius. She urged them to accept the uncommon woman and learn to applaud. And again, I'll read you part of what Ely has written. All that follows is for women. The men are not forbidden, but they are advised not to read it. A man always does anything he wants, particularly if it's forbidden. It is so from his earliest days. At age 6, he says to himself, if I climbed to the top of that barn, I wonder if I would see anything I never saw before. He climbs to the top of the barn. He sees fields, woods, houses that he did not even know existed. And he perceives that the world is large, unexpectedly large. His mother comes out of the house and sees him on the barn. She does not scold him. She thinks he is splendidly adventurous. She mends his torn trousers without complaining. But let her little daughter show any such inclination to see the world. She is called names that are a shock to her innocence. She is told that she is the tomboy, a terrible word. Her budding modesty is offended. She drops bitter tears into her little checked apron and admits to herself that she was very naughty indeed to try to find out if the world was large. She discovers that for a woman, it is not large, that is to say, no larger than the dooryard. And in a little while, she too has a contempt for a woman who tries to get up where she can look off and see what the world is like. It is this placing of limitation above women by the women themselves that always seems to me to be the most irritating of things. There are some women who always resent the success of any other woman. I think women do not always appreciate one another. I've often noticed the girls in dry goods stores. They are a good illustration of the point I wish to illustrate. There they stand, tired, dusty, harassed by senseless customers, the day stretching out before them in interminable length. Yet almost always they are kind to each other, are sisterly and courteous. There are exceptions, but the exceptions are few. I don't know exactly what they would do, though, if they got a genius among them. Perhaps they would find it hard to invent excuses for her. But so long as a woman allows only well-bred mediocrity, she will find affectionate friends. Now, women want to stop the placing of limitations. They want to get over their narrowness of aspect. They want to learn to applaud. If a woman makes a success of anything, from walking a tightrope to painting a picture, give her credit for it. Do not call her a crank because she has ideas. Do not cut her because she knows enough to make a living. Try to get to a point where you could admit that she's nice in spite of the fact that she has opinions. It is this fighting shy of the women who are trying to march with the marching time that I most deprecate in women. I don't like them to be afraid of genius. Genius isn't necessarily disreputable. Make way for the uncommon woman as well as the common ones. When you hear a remarkable orator such as Mrs. Leese, do not say that she ought to stay home and take care of the children. The children will be taken care of all right. You needn't worry about that. But give the women a chance to do something else. It is the women themselves to whom I am talking. It is they who build the barriers. And I want to see them all knocked down, all those moss-grown walls erected by superstition and tradition and prejudice. Flowers will not grow in the shadow of a stone wall. You have to let the sunshine get in at them. And the last one I would like to close with is from the chapter People and Places, and it's her comments on Willa Cather. Petey earned extra money by lecturing throughout Nebraska on literary topics. At one lecture that Ely presented on Sidney Lanier at the University of Nebraska, she met Willa Cather. In 1895, the year Cather graduated from the university, Petey wrote a history of Nebraska women journalists for the Nebraska Press Association. Petey complimented Cather. Her criticisms, both literary and dramatic, are clever, original, and generally just. But above all, they are clever and full of ginger. If there is a woman in Nebraska newspaper work who is destined to win a reputation for herself, that woman is Willa Cather. Indeed, without flattery, it can be said that honest workmanship already distinguishes her columns. One of the first to predict Cather's future success, Petey wrote in an 1895 column, "There is no better literary work done in this state than that on the Lincoln Courier, and the writing which is best in the columns of that paper is by two women, Miss Sarah Harris and Miss Willa Cather." Miss Cather is exceedingly young to do such good work as she does, and her opinions, original, often dogmatic, frequently charming and piquant, are poured into those columns with all the prodigality of youth and the enthusiasm of high talent. In 1896, Petey devoted a column to a Cather short story, On the Divide, one of the first short stories written by the young woman destined to become the editor of McClure's, as well as the Pulitzer Prize-winning and internationally acclaimed author. Cather, in return, respected Petey. In a letter Cather wrote from Pittsburgh to Kate Cleary, who was Elia's friend, on the 25th of February, 1905, Cather stated that she read Petey's stories as a young girl in Red Cloud, almost worshiping Petey as an author, and commented that no other person had been so constant, kind, and influential in her writing career. Petey's stimulating and charming personality and her unconscious talent for helping others, Cather wrote, always uplifted her. In her memoir, Petey described Cather as always a cordial, simple friend, and they visited each other often in each other's homes. This is just a short part from this column. Miss Willa Cather, who has done a good deal of newspaper work in Lincoln, has a story in the January number of the Overland Monthly. Since Miss Cather was born and raised in Nebraska and has not seen much of any other part of the world, she has wisely set her characters down on the Nebraska plains. Perhaps, to speak more correctly, the tale is really one of the plains, and the characters of the people merely inevitable incidents of their surrounding. Miss Cather has long confessed herself in her literary criticisms an admirer of what is primitive, simple, and vital in art. She likes a stirring tale, and the young woman who said that the creative ability of a woman as fictionist would be demonstrated when they wrote good sea stories or stories of battle, as if they had much opportunity of knowing about fights by sea or land. Miss Cather has not written about a fight, but she has made a mighty Norse who, transplanted from his native hemlocks to the bare plains of Nebraska, lives in miserable and alcoholic solitude for 10 long years, and who, in desperate protest against the unnatural loneliness of his situation, finally goes to a house, asks a young sweet woman to marry him, and when she refuses, takes her in his giant arms and carries her off through a gathering blizzard to his own shack, in spite of the wails of her father and mother and her own hearty resistance. So she goes on and talks some more about the story. So all of this is rather discouraging, but the stories and poems born out here in the plains all do seem to be discouraging. Are they really as bad as the fictionalists paint? Or have we caught a miserable melancholy from Mr. Hamlin Garland? And have we not the sense to make good selections for the subjects of our fiction? Miss Cather's story, for all of its extravagances, rings true, and it seems to be sad because conditions are sad. Other writers as good have taken their metal cameras, so to speak, to the same region and brought away equally depressing negatives. If one were rich, it would be amusing to offer a prize for the best rollicking story of the plains, produced by a person who had lived on them, and await the results. I'd like to end with some quotes by Elia, and you can go to the next one. They have to click it one more time. We don't have coffee. Usually when I give presentations, we have coffee. But we don't have to have any here tonight. One of the most enjoyable things about reading Elia is that everything that she's written, there's always one or two or three sentences that you can take away that have a very humorous twist or a very strong philosophical thought. And so I've compiled some of my favorite ones here. Some of them are in the book and some of them are not. And I like this one. Another one. We are all country folk together, though some of us may not know it. Yes, go ahead. That any day seems dull as a confession of personal limitation. Oppression makes poets. In the land of perfect liberty, songs are not pressed out of the heart. Robert and I passed socially from aspiring bohemia to aspiring suburbia, sort of like hippies and yuppies, huh? Perhaps on the whole, the community is kinder to those who were born and have grown up here than to those who have come in. Love is, of course, an illusion. All the really important things are. It does not come to everyone to have a heroic moment. Most women have to lead quiet and monotonous lives. The problems of life bear very little resemblance to problems in arithmetic, and there is by no rule by which they can be solved. It is really so amazing that we would permit so many twigs to start crooked and then punish them when they are grown up because they are not straight trees. The essence of souls is a curious thing. It is present at birth. Nothing ever really alters it. I have noticed that when a man wishes to be particularly unfair, that he calls it being practical. When a man is miserable, why is he always wants the woman he loves best to be even a little more miserable than he is? Gossip is envy with a black mask. Whenever one succeeds, he or she pays the penalty by incurring the displeasure of the small-spirited. It is the little dogs who bark the most. To know the hour and to be the man, that is magnificent. And my favorite quote, make room for the uncommon woman as well as the common ones. I'd like to read a final paragraph here. Petey had vitality, intellect, and dedication. During her Omaha years, she gained strength from her various roles as writer and woman in her struggle for self-definition and economic survival. A passion for writing burned within her throughout her life, but the works that she published during these years would attain the greatest depth and breadth and vitality that she would ever achieve. Her energy and commitment to personal, intellectual, cultural, and social improvement not only serve effectively in presenting a balanced portrait of America in the Gilded Age, as the Gilded Age merged into the Progressive Era, but they also depict a region and a people having interminable possibilities. Despite her impertinence, or perhaps because of it, she emerged as a spirited voice in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Thank you.